All right, so ladies and gentlemen, it's very strange for me to do an intro sitting down. It feels very like I'm going to have a cup of tea. I'm normally sort of standing up, so it feels very decorous. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests and speakers, good afternoon. A very warm welcome to the EWEA debate on power system transformation entitled Getting More Renewables Online, How Should We Operate Our Power Systems? Firstly, thank you very much for coming to lend your ears, and I really do hope also your brains to the occasion. Now, whether it was because you simply wanted to leave work early, put your hands up if all you wanted to do was leave work early. See, no one's... Yeah, this guy, well, there you go, you want to leave work. Because wind power's your thing, or because, frankly, you're just here for the free drinks at the other side of the hour and a half debate, we salute you. As you know, I don't know how many of you were in the debate, the recent debate on subsidies, and you may know that this is actually part, this is the second in a trilogy of debates. So the first took place in April, and it focused on fossil fuel subsidies. Did anybody attend that one? Oh, well, of course you did, yes. You're like the good student. Me. Now, there's a clue for you in terms of what we'd like to stay focused on today, please. It's not subsidies. We've been there, we've done that, all right? All the grid debate in terms of hardware. This afternoon's chat is going to look at some of the success stories in Europe that show how renewables can be maximised on the power grid, in spite of the oft-heard comment that we cannot put more renewable energy online because of its variability. Now, it explores what we know about ways in which power systems should be operated in order to bring more renewables online. It looks at the role of decision makers, regulators. We've got a TSO here. Hands up, TSO person. There we go. In achieving this, and of course, at market design, which is where we think the discussion is going to go quite nicely. So that gives you another clue. If we integrate renewables, what is the future of the energy market? What do we need? And what should be more Europeanised? So there's a lot to cover, and in not a lot of time, very, very briefly, what's the schedule? We've got five fantastic smile guys. Dazzle them with your gorgeous dental work. Five fantastic speakers who'll give you a super short presentation. Might make you smile, might make you grumble, shout, throw eggs, applaud, fall asleep. I don't know. They are, on my left, Simon Müller, Analyst System Integration of Renewables International Energy Agency, Oliver Koch, Deputy Head of Unit, Wholesale Markets, Electricity and Gas, Directorate General for Energy, European Commission. Next to him, we have David Ringmar, Director and Head of Strategy and Asset Management of Nordic Region Vattenfall. Tahir Kapitanovic, Head of Control Centre, Austrian Power Grid. And finally on the end, Paul Wilczek. Is that right? All right? Oh, no, you're not very good. It's okay. Senior Political Affairs Advisor, Grid and Internal Electricity Market, European Wind Energy Association. So I'm sure, probably because you guys have done the circuit, you know variously where they're coming from and what they're going to be talking about. Now, after their chat, they have 7 minutes, and I'm really going to keep them to this maximum 7 minutes. After they've done their presentations, I really do want to hear your contributions. This is the opportunity. You can make the most of their knowledge. You can grill them. You can make them feel awful. You can make them feel happy, whatever you like. Please sharpen your minds, sharpen your pencils, scribble down your questions. It's your chance. We're here for a debate. But please keep it to the point. No rambling, no eulogising from the pulpit. We really don't have a lot of time. Same goes for these guys, please. And the one thing I do want to say is I wear this big bloke's watch because I'm mistress of the clock, okay? That means it's my job to keep to time so that we have as much input as possible from everybody. Please don't be shy. So that means if I stop these guys after 7 minutes or I stop you guys, it's simply my job. I will be polite. No worries there. For the same reason, no big intros. They're all clever. They've all got big brains. You probably know them already. So no big intros about who you are. So any questions? Are we all good? Still happy with where we're sitting? Sure? Okay. So, on my left, who's up first? Simon Müller, the floor is yours. Now, I believe you're going to present some of the key outcomes of recent research. Oh, you're looking at me terrified, in case you're not. Conducted by the IEA that looks at increased power system flexibility, broadly? We hope.
Apparently, yeah.
Okay. Well, there we go. The 7 minutes now starts now, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon to all of you, and thanks also for the kind introduction. I work in flexibility, and I'll need some of that on my own side. I had prepared some introductory notes, which definitely wouldn't amount to first 7 minutes of speaking and wouldn't really summarize the work that we've recently done at the IEA on grid integration. However, I'm very happy to share some of the results that we found there. The IEA has worked on exactly this question. What happens when you get more wind and solar into the power grid? As most of you will know, the wind is not always available, sun is not always available, and that has an imprint on the generation of wind and solar. So they're variable. At the same time, we can't store electricity. We always have to have the balance of supply and demand, and therefore there's a natural concern, well, if that happens, the power system might fall apart. It might become incredibly expensive. We might get into a blackout. So it's a very pertinent question to ask, how can you operate a system that remains secure? And the IEA has been working on this question since about 2005, when we got the first mandate for that. I was in charge for the third phase of this work that we completed over about 2.5 years, and where we looked at the situation on the ground in 15 different countries that we aggregated to 7 case study regions. And we were speaking with TSOs, with market operators, asking the question, well, okay, so how can you do it? How can you operate a power system with a high share of variable generation? And I would say that the first observation, and maybe the European debate is already somewhat past this point, but is saying that load itself, of course, is variable, and we do have the resources on the power system to balance this variability. It's just a huge change in the mindset of people operating the system to realize it's not load that is variable and generation that is flexible to balance that load, but to say we're going to take the variable part of the generation, put it together with the load that's been variable all along, and we're going to balance it that way. So we're going to balance net load, taking into account the variability of wind and solar. And that's really a paradigm change that takes a while to be fully implemented in operations. And I would say in those countries that are just starting, which surely isn't that much Europe anymore, that's still a process that is underway. Now, when we go to the next level and say, we've done that, we've used these flexibility assets that we've had in the past, and we kind of treated variable renewables as a negative load, then the picture increasingly starts to change. Essentially, what we need to do is we need to find a way of informing the way we operate the power system about the state of the variable renewables. How are they going to generate tomorrow? How much wind will we have? How much sun will we have? Where do we actually have solar installations? Where do we have wind installations? The Spanish TSC, Red Eléctrica, as many other TSOs, will always stress what you need is observability and controllability. You need to know what are these generation resources doing, and you need to have the capability to intervene if you need to. I would say that's the next principal step of operating a system at high shares of wind and solar without having it fall apart or causing blackouts. Then at an increasing level of the challenge, it's about finding better ways to learn what's coming and to use forecasts in real-time operation. I'm going to give you some examples. You can forecast load pretty well, and power systems always hold reserves to balance this load. Now, these reserves are often determined months in advance, because you can, you know it's going to be winter, you know it's going to be summer. However, if you keep that strategy and you have a lot of wind and solar, it becomes very ineffective, because actually the amount of reserves that you need to cater for the uncertainty that's coming depends on how much wind you'll have and how much sun. So one thing that needs to be done is to change the way we get reserves. And more than that, we need to change the way what kind of reserves we have, because the nature of the uncertainty, the things that might happen tomorrow, are different in a system with more wind and sun. I'll give you one example. Take a wind forecast. A wind forecast error, usually if you say you have a large wind ramp that you don't expect, that the weather system plays out in a totally different way than you were expecting, that's a process that unfolds over several hours. That's not something that TSOs are usually used to hold reserves against. They hold reserves against one big power plant tripping off all at the same time. It's not so much a ramping reserve product that would help to balance that kind of uncertainty. And that brings me to the next level, essentially. So we need to find a way to operate the system that takes into account the uncertainties and that uses the available flexibility in the best possible way to cater for the variability coming from wind and solar. It's also about how do we manage the exchange schedules on our transmission lines? Can we actually change the schedule of how we want to exchange power between two countries, not only on the day ahead, but maybe half an hour ahead, or maybe even 5 minutes ahead? That will also affect how well you can balance the variability between different regions. And maybe in a final step, what needs to be done is all of this has basically happened, all of this balancing, all of this flexibility has happened in the corner of the power systems historically. So if you look at the spot market revenue in Germany a few years ago, it's about 98% of the money, or let's say the trade of bulk power. That's more accurate, the trade of bulk power. The trade of reserves is 2%. and this flexibility. It's very, very small, and that actually holds for a wide range of markets. It's not that big of a deal. Because of that, people weren't paying attention to how these markets were designed. And because flexibility is becoming more important, we're currently going through a process, and I think that's going to be taking up a lot of our discussion, of how we can actually design these markets in a way that those services that become critical when you have high shares of wind and solar actually get remunerated correctly. Maybe one final point on this. One could say, well, all we need to do is get flexibility markets right, and there's some proposals on the table of how to do that. The problem will be solved. I would say I disagree. Having the right market in place is a precondition for this to work, but I would say by itself it might not be sufficient. Why? Many of you will be familiar with the effect that we're currently seeing on European wholesale power markets with declining prices. Essentially, what's happening is we have a compounding effect of an economic crisis, and the additional supply of variable renewables coming in, and an investment wave in new generation just a few years ago. What's happening is we have oversupply, and because of that, depressed prices. I would say we have a similar effect in terms of flexibility. When you start introducing wind and solar, there can be paradoxic effects that you actually need less flexibility than more during a transition phase. And a lot of the power plants that are sitting idle and not producing power can actually provide flexibility. So we have the problem that even if flexibility were adequately priced today, it wouldn't have a value on the market. And I think that is an essential part of the discussion and the problem. And maybe one final comment, and I'll leave it at that. If we look at the barrier to renewables deployment, it's clear every single time a technical barrier has been expressed as a maximum level, this has been overcome. And I don't think there is a technical barrier for this. And I would say the main barrier is also today in Europe not about the operation of the power system and operating them in the most flexible way. I think the problem is that we've induced overcapacity in a system. We've induced a huge transfer of wealth between conventional generators, renewable generators, wholesale consumers, small-scale consumers, and that is at the heart of the political debate, which currently could be the bigger obstacle to sustained renewables deployment.
Thank you. Thank you very much. See, he's a good student. Didn't even have to tell him to wind up. Thank you for setting the scene. Thank you for the context. Hold your questions. I hope you already have some. If not, I trust that Oliver Koch from the European Commission will certainly generate some. Thank you. The floor is yours.
I do my best. I was indeed not even prepared for a seven-minute speech here. My intention is indeed to discuss, not only with the distinguished colleagues here, but with you. And therefore, very, very short. I mean, immediate comments, I would have a few. I mean, it's flexibility. Maybe I'm a bit more optimistic on flexibility. Pricing, that's at least something we are looking at very carefully and very concretely. The other thing is what I would invite you and the audience to understand, I mean, as a regulator, the one thing is the analysis, and I think that's the problem of the whole debate, market design, and can the market cope with renewables. Yes, there's a technocratic engineering economic side of it, but I mean, we neglect the political discussion in this. And the major decisions that have been taken in the past were political decisions. Yes, we have oversupply, but my politicians who decide on market design and will and are taking every month now groundbreaking decisions on market design, they come to us being informed that we have a risk of blackouts everywhere. They're panicking throughout Europe, and they're being informed that we have a massive problem all over Europe of blackouts, some say due to renewables, some say due to all kinds of other developments. But you cannot underestimate how powerful these arguments are, and that a wonderful IEA study where you get a majority amongst experts how you could design something in future can be thrown to a bin within minutes if a politician is informed by lobbyists, and we're all lobbyists in a way, that he has a problem in his constituency that next winter might not be 100% sure in terms of electricity. So it's just a remark. We have a purely political debate, and that's a remark to the IEA and to many scholars working on capacity markets, market design questions. even more so in the EU. The EU is a very special animal. It's a composition of 28 member states, integrated even with more member states in an integrated grid, where certain assumptions and doing analyses with national configurations doesn't do the trick. That applies for capacity mechanisms, for instance. It's not enough to look at how does it develop in a single state. In the EU context, what mattered is what does it do to the internal market in a synchronized grid. That is a different ballgame, and I always really invite people to look at European market design and not at national examples, which is always the first example because that's all your contact points. They have more resources, and that's the case studies you often have. So that's the two introductory remarks, really. And we have a specific animal here with the European energy market and the European market design, where national member states, yes, are responsible for most of the key decisions, but where we want and see the benefit of the internal market, and we have to take into account every effect of a single solar panel in southern Germany beyond the borders. So what do I want to discuss from our side? It can be very, very short. My question is, market design, yes, we've made a proposal, we've developed it years ago. Key question, can we keep it? Should we keep it? And do we stick to a market design, or should we acknowledge the facts and say we go to another model? And we are discussing it every day, the CapEx, OpEx worlds and the different investment needs and the long-term investment dilemma and so on and so forth. It's a very pertinent question, and we have to make far-reaching decisions in the next months, I would say, on this dilemma. And the second thing I would like, since I have hopefully an audience also with a lot of people from the renewables world, I would really like to have clarity how the renewables world positions itself in this discussion. Do we keep a market? Do we want a market approach? Or do we want a different model? And I don't want to hear, yes, we want a market. Everybody wants a market. I have not heard anybody saying, I don't support the internal market. Yes, we know this. But it boils really down now to very concrete questions. And these decisions are taking how do you position yourself on the debate on state interventions? How do you position yourself on investment? And sorry to come to subsidies, also to subsidy questions. So this is something where I see some movement. So to the two questions, where are we? From the Commission side, it's relatively easy. We've said our market design is the target model. It was thought through, and Tahir and colleagues have developed it 10 years ago in a world that was certainly not the renewables world. I don't think they were totally surprised of what is happening, to be honest, because it was clear that we would have certain developments, but I think nobody saw what was happening in Germany with solar and what was happening in other countries and the rapidity of certain developments. So yes, there's a target model in a world with a stable base load generation where many people ask us, is this model appropriate? And not only on a short-term basis, can it avoid blackouts? Can it react? Does it have sufficient focus on the short-term markets, balancing markets, intraday markets? They are not in the focus in terms of harmonization speed. They will come very, very late. We are focusing very much on day-ahead market coupling. Is this the right thing? Will this do the trick? That's one of the questions. Our answer has always been yes. We stick to our guns. We don't change the horses in the middle of the race. Let the target model work. Let market coupling kick in. Let the harmonization of intraday and day-ahead and balancing rules kick in that will stimulate demand side, and everything will be sorted out. So don't lose the faith in it. However, I want to be very realistic with you. We live in a world of state interventions, and I don't blame the renewables world. Its Hinkley point is as much a state intervention as a renewable scheme for solar in Germany is. And the reality is we will be living with this type of severe interventions in the markets for quite a while. That's the first truth. And I'm not talking about the capacity mechanisms that will kick in gradually and have a tremendous effect, unfortunately, on the internal market if we don't get them right. I'm also talking about the harmonization that we always promise as the solution. It's so important for renewables to have aggregated areas, to have aggregated rules and not national fragmentation. But let's face it, the proposals we get on the harmonization provide for a staggered, a long time for the implementation of this harmonization. If you take the balancing markets, the current proposals and the current approach is a gradual, soft moderation process where we develop a model, refine it, and then in 7, 8, 9 years, we'll hopefully have something like imbalance pricing and a type of joint balancing market that theoretically I could design you tomorrow. I could write it down. I could design you, give the rules, and say this is how you just have to implement it. The implementation of all this will take long, and even market coupling, intraday market coupling, I have to tell you, and I shouldn't do it, but I hope it's Chatham House rules here, will take a bit. So if we take this situation, we have two recipes. We can say we force it through. Our recipe is still contain the damage. We stick to defending the model, the market. We might need some patches, and that's the patches. We'll be accepting capacity models, not fighting without any scope for compromise against renewable support schemes and forcing them to sort out tomorrow. We had a compromise with the renewables world. We will now go into a fight with a coal and other world on capacity schemes. But we will have to accept interventions that will persist. We try our best to preserve the market in the time until the rules really kick in, but this will be an uphill fight. We need to speed up balancing rules. We need to get better market rules. We need also to get cross-border connected capacity schemes and many, many groundwork. But we are not ready yet to say, okay, we see that the merit curve is over, this merit-based investment model, we give it up. Or Boston Consulting Belgium was out with a big article saying again, listen, guys, markets in electricity, that's a non-go. It's a no-go. That was a nice idea 10 years ago, but it doesn't work. And I can tell you, I get more and more of these articles from very educated people in companies, in the politics, and politicians are, as you know, for this kind of argument, very receptive. So what I cannot tell you is whether we succeed in defend the market. We are committed to do so. We don't know. My question to you is, where are you in this discussion? It's a very easy one.
Okay, and a few more than that. I need to ask you to wind up. Are you there?
But I want to give two sub-questions because for me that's important.
Blimey. Get your pens out.
You say you need aggregation and you say you need the cross-border dimension of the market, and you see how dangerous capacity markets are. But I feel still that you're not really committed to believing in the current market model also for long-term investment. So I would be really interested, are you on the side of the market, or do you also think it's rather an outdated model and we should fundamentally change the model, not only the short-term trading, but also the investment construction, merit-based pricing.
Okay, do you want people to take a standing vote now?
My question, indeed. And if we have a vote...
Right, let's do a vote now. Okay, stand up if you believe in the model. Literally. Go on, stand up if you believe in the target model. You still... Oh, nobody wants to stand. They're sitting comfortably. Okay, and those who don't? Who want to replace it with another kind of... one gentleman. Okay, he'll be scribbling on a napkin his ideas. Okay, there's a lot of questions there. So if you've got anything to answer on those with the sub-questions, the sub-sub-questions B and C, if you want to have a stand on the political, what he said about the political dimension with the politicians and member states, the fact that, of course, the EU is a very specific animal, that's very, very clear. Can we, should we keep market design, go for another model, and how does the renewables world position itself in this discussion? I can see your cogs at the end of there really turning. You're going to leap on that one, aren't you, when the time comes. Thank you very much, Oliver, for all of that and for expressing it so clearly. Right. Could I now give the floor to David Ringmar, Director and Head of Strategy and Asset Management, Nordic Region Vattenfall. You are the leading energy producer in the Nordic region and one of Europe's leading generators of electricity and heat. David, the next few minutes are yours.
Thank you. Fantastic for being here. Thank you for the invitation. I guess I can give you some perspectives from the Nordics, what we believe is functioning as of a generation player in the Nordics, trying to safeguard or possibly increase our value of our assets. Around the question of how to integrate more renewables, I think the fundamentally most important question is that it is perceived to be effective and it functions. So we can create the trust that it will function. And how do you do that then? I think we need to have an effective and efficient market model. Our experiences from the Nordics is that our market model, the energy only market, functions very well. It has been robust. It is a very efficient and model that actually uses the right resources at the right times, we believe. Taking that model, I think, step by step, we will be managing integration in the speed that we're doing of our renewable. That's my fundamental belief. I think it's also a proof that it functions by the fact that all those low prices that we see does not give us any signals to invest in capacity, which is good because that just makes it functioning because there is an oversupply. Of course, there can be a lot of improvements in the model. One can sort of improve all the price signals to really come through at all times, having intraday trading that is 15 minutes instead of 1 hour, sort of being very much more sort of transparent, making the errors of forecasting wind, etc., might be lower, etc. But I think the fact that the price is the messenger is fundamental for us, and we believe that is the way to go. It makes our lives easier, it makes it transparent and much more effective, is my total view here. I think the second step is, of course, to utilize the elasticity of the demand. It has totally not been used at all. In the midterm, I think that's very, very, very important for an integration of renewables to really be at any levels that we want it to be. I think 2025 we will have a market in the Nordics, for example, that will be significant for a demand response, for example, and that will be a big help for any integration of renewables. And I think the last point that I want to mention is that I think this increase of cross-national optimization is just needs to happen. I mean, increased investments in transmission, increased interconnection. Of course, there's a question around how nations will figure out around or think around security supply. Will they have sort of reserve capacity for the nation, or can they believe that they can optimize through regions or whatever? That's much more a political question. But I totally believe that we just need to go there. Just taking a step back, thinking of if we would be China, for example, we would be regions. All the nations in Europe. And we have different ability to produce power, but the demand is elsewhere. Of course you want to optimize over the whole region. It's just fundamentally true, I think. So I think we just need to optimize over a bigger perspective, regions or a whole, in a much better way that we're doing today. So I think those three sort of, we need to have a market model that is efficient and trustworthy. I think we just need to increased elasticity of demand, and I think we just need to optimize over bigger regions. That will create the trust that the integration of renewable needs, because that's fundamental for the perception that it functions.
Okay, thank you very much. So we're reinforcing there also perception. You talked also about mindset, so that's a whole part of the equation, apart from just how it integrated on a technical level and infrastructural level. Thank you for that. So now we are coming to you. I've already read yours. I could read out your fantastic one-page contribution.
It's good, but
it is good. I did. I gave it an A-plus star.
German,
that's what we...
In the first year, I would do it always in advance. Yeah.
It was very, very good, very concise. Yeah. So, but I will let you deliver it yourself. Thank you very much. So we're going to move from utilities to a TSO.
Yeah.
Please give a warm welcome to Tahir Kapitanovic, Head of Control Centre, Austrian Power Grid. You're an independent control area manager and transmission operator of the Austrian extra high voltage grid.
Thank you so much. The reason why we have to be well prepared is that our job is very simple. They say your past follows you wherever you go. So as Oliver put it, indeed, I probably bear part of responsibility for the market model as it is today and so on, because I worked for regulator for some time. But I shall say we did not expect it happen that fast and in that way. And what I will be saying in the next few minutes is about these patches. You call it patches, I like the word patches, I call it tools, whatever you like to call it, which we really need to make this a success. Because first of all, and as a practitioner every day from the control room, I can tell you we need every single megawatt of capacity and every single megawatt hour of energy which is produced in Europe from anything, It doesn't matter. Is it wind, solar, biomass, biogas? I don't care. We need it. Why do we need it? Because you know that the gas price keeps the gas out of merit. Last year, over summer, and this winter, we have about 8,000 megawatt decommissioned gas generation in Europe. You know that you have the price spread diminishing, the peak to low, the peak to base is almost disappeared, which even challenges the economic viability of hydro. You also know we have nuclear phase out, and we have really difficulties to get, not to get lines built, but to get license to build a line. So this put together, if we want this transition to happen, we will need any kind of generation, whatever you like it. So let us finish with this perception. Sometimes TSOs don't like wind, don't like sun. We like everything. We are operators of the grid. We are operators of the system. But in order to make it really happen, in order to use it and not to waste money, resources, to destroy welfare. Now, I have a TSO hat, but I still remember times when I worked for a regulator. It was always the question of the welfare. What is there for the customer? And it's obviously not there for the customer if price of electricity is minus 100 euro per megawatt hour. This does not work in any market, neither should it be so in electricity. So in order to avoid negative prices, in order to avoid troubles, in order to avoid, I don't like the word blackouts, but in order to avoid problems in the future, we need really some tools. And by tools, I don't mean here another security initiatives. Maybe some of you have heard the TSOs of Europe pulled together in TSC, which is a TSO security cooperation of 13 TSOs of Central Europe, with an office in Munich, or it Coreza, which has office here in Brussels. We use this initiative to do operational planning close to real time. No, I don't mean this. I neither mean any kind of good software or hardware or equipment, anything. No, what I mean is a set of measures. Oliver call it patches, set of measures, set of tools, set of things that need to be added on top of our regular balancing market, load frequency control and everything, because we have a new world coming, we have a new generation mix. So I'll try to make it practical and specific, again, as guy from operations with very simple job, keeping the lights on, we are always kind of to the roots, back to the roots and try to be concrete as possible. There are three issues. One is to keep secure and balanced system. The second one is to have services and market needed for that. And the third one is the framework. I can talk about anyone. Maybe to start with balancing and security. Apart from all the things we know, it boils down to keeping the equilibrium between the trading away volatility. This is done by German TSOs already. In Austria, we're introducing it close to real time in order to hedge it somehow, in order not to waste it, and the time you need to analyze the grid. As TSOs, we do something called operational security analysis. I hope you have heard about N-1 principle. It's very simple. Tripping out of one line should not jeopardize the system otherwise. So to calculate, for example, in Central Europe, which is a TSC area, this TSO security cooperation, to calculate about a little bit more than 4,000 N-1 cases for 24 hours of the coming time, you need at least 1 hour, this is our experience, before the real time where the positions are fixed. So that trading, intraday trading, goes up to 1 hour before real time, because then we have sufficient time to do this analysis and, even more important, organize and prepare any needed control action. Now, I'm not saying this is something you need in Scandinavia, because in Scandinavia, you have much simpler, if I may say so. I mean, maybe you are lucky, you have not so heavily meshed grid as it is in Central Europe. So there, the time needed might be less. The second of those issues, I mentioned market or services or however you call it. There are some missing links. We have a plethora of ancillary services already in place, like reactive power voltage, balancing, and so on. But we'll need some new. We will need some new, first of all, because by replacement of conventional generation by wind and solar power, we are losing one very old-fashioned feature, which is heavy rotating masses. Every synchronous machine has a generator which has a lot of tons. It's very heavy. By being heavy, it keeps the system stable and resistant to sudden disturbances. By losing this kind of generators, I mean, no, we are not losing it, they are getting out of the system. We need a kind of ancillary services to provide this inertia back in the system when we replace it by different kind of generation which doesn't have so heavy rotating machines. The next one is the local storage. I mean, what we see whenever you have a negative price, I mean, what would you do if by selling the good you produce you have to pay? Well, I will store it for later on. So there needs to be incentive. There needs to be incentive, and this is one of these patches Oliver mentioned, to really make business out of local storage, saving electricity when it's negative, when its price is negative, to sell it when it's positive. And it will, of course, help us, because then I will not have to cope with overloaded lines, because everybody is just trying to get rid of whatever the electricity produced everywhere in the wrong time and in the wrong place. And finally, as I said, there is a good example for this. This is, for example, in Scandinavia. Scandinavian countries combine it together with demand response. Norway is keeping pace with their peak load already since 1996 using the demand response. I don't mean load shedding. I mean really commercially driven and run demand response features and services that the market participants provide. And finally, the third key issue is, as I mentioned, because of volatility and because of the speed, there is lower predictability. In order to hedge this away, we as TSOs, we will need short-term access to generating capacities capable of balancing it. I'm not talking about balancing market, neither about faster automatic reserves. I'm talking that, for example, on a scale of 3 hours or 1 hour or 2 hours, you would need to access generation to redispatch. So it's not keeping frequency, it's keeping system alive, so not overloading and tripping out your lines. So basically, this is my wish list. It's very concrete, it's very specific, and once again, I shall underline, if we manage to get these tools, and it's really not difficult to get them, together with framework conditions, with network codes which have been prepared, and they should enter into force sooner than later, not just for our sake, for the TSOs, but for the interests of every stakeholders. And if we combine it with much better, hopefully faster, licensing of new lines, yes, then I really believe we will have success out of this so-called Energiewende. I believe the English word is energy turnaround or new energy of Europe, however you like to call it. If you fail it, if we don't get this tool in our hands, we are able to keep the system running still, we are, and we will be doing so in the future. But if we don't get this handful of tools, of measures we need, patches, as Oliver called it, then I'm afraid a lot is at stake. We are in a danger of failure and maybe of losing this opportunity, today's opportunity, a unique opportunity to create the new, clean, sustainable, and really secure electricity future of Europe in the next maybe 20 or 10 or 20 years. I was less than 7 minutes, I think.
Thank you. Very good. You did. And thank you for ending on a positive note. I hope the gentleman on your left is going to start on a positive note. Paul, Senior Political Affairs Advisor, European Wind Energy Association. The floor is yours. I think you've got something that you're prepared to say now, and then I'm sure you're going to come back on what Oliver asked earlier. Let's hear what you have to say, please.
Thank you very much. Indeed, a lot has been said already, and I want to address some of the points that were said and respond to them directly, as well as having still my introduction that I was thinking of giving. First of all, I wanted to pick up two points that were mentioned by Simon. I'm very grateful for that, controllability and visibility. A little bit about system operation before we inevitably, I think, dive into more the market design questions. I'm grateful that you mentioned that because these are really two key features, two enablers, I would say, for really removing the technical issues that were thought of when introducing large amounts of variable renewables. And why controllability and visibility? There is a lot of best practices out there from which we can learn. I might just point out one, which is Spain, which is a quasi-energy island, if you want, very little interconnectivity with the rest of Europe, and a very high share of variable renewables, a very high share of wind energy. What they have done to increase controllability and visibility is basically introduced a control center. The TSO has introduced a control center that monitors and forecasts the output on a regular basis of 98% of the wind generation in Spain, providing regular forecasts and basically having everything online on a remote control if you want. And by this means, they have done a splendid job in integrating these large amounts of wind energy in a cost-efficient manner. So these are the best practices that we have that we should learn from to basically prove this is not a technical issue. What is the issue now is how do we do it in a most cost-effective way? And this brings me to, well, a more market design debate, if you want. There I do want, of course, to address what was raised earlier by Oliver. On which side are we? Well, you know, if you want to summarize the whole debate, you can say there's two camps. Yeah. So the first camp is basically thinking, well, the energy-only market model has probably, you know, failed and is beyond repair. We are now facing capacity remuneration mechanisms. You know, they are spreading out like mushrooms everywhere, and we are moving towards a more, you know, centralistic concession-based energy system. The other camp is, well, the energy-only market model has its problems, but they can be solved with some adjustments, and this is what we have to work on. For me, the essential thing that we have to answer before we can actually go into one of these two camps is what is actually the system adequacy that we are talking about right now. What is the capacity problem on the long term, and what is the capacity problem on the short term in terms of flexibility? This is unsolved right now. I'm really grateful that your colleagues at N2E now start to tackle this with the you have the so-called SOAF, System Outlook and Adequacy Forecast, which was in the past more, well, more deterministic. You are basically stacking up the megawatts available in Europe and then seeing how this compares to peak load. Right now, the methodology is being, revised, and we are going into a much more probabilistic methodology, which takes into account, you know, how much wind energy, solar is produced when, and, you know, doing this kind of statistics. So I think once this is clarified, we are aware what is the problem, how big it is, and you know, and where do we possibly have to intervene in terms of market interventions in form of some sort of capacity mechanisms, if at all. I must say, from the wind industry, well, we are still in the camp of the believers. I mean, we are getting ready to enter the market in the power systems where we have more and more penetration levels of wind energy. For us, it's clear that you cannot have priority dispatch when you have over, I don't know, a 20% penetration level and during a time of negative prices. Of course, you should not be dispatched then. By the way, interestingly, you know, so when you look at the dispatch snapshot at that moment, you see coal power plants running through there as well. So it's not only us doing that. But of course, you should not be dispatched, as clear as that. And we are pretty good at that because you can switch us off as wind turbines quite quickly. We are developing all the thinking about how we can adapt to the market when high shares of renewables are reached. There, I think it is fair to say that the energy-only market, well, will have its challenges. We will face, on average, low average spot market prices. However, what we see missing right now, and this is also one of the research that we carry out, you see these reports. I think in front of the room, we have carried out a study called Reservices, where we look at so-called grid support services. Would you refer to what is going to be increasingly important in the future are these so-called grid support services that were in the past, well, that still are actually carried out most of the time by conventionals, frequency support, voltage support. This is clearly something that renewables will have to take up in the future. The capabilities are there. I mean, you will have that engineer that can provide that capability in a machine. The question is, what is then the most cost-efficient way? What can we commoditize there to make sure that these system that this grid support services are provided in the most cost-efficient manner? What can be provided by a power generation asset? What could be provided by somebody else? Is there anything that we can market as maybe a big word, but a procurement scheme to then see that, you know, we get the services that we need for the most affordable prices? So I think this is also something that we have to go to beyond the energy market model. This is a new market model, if you want, or a new a part of the internal energy market, really, because we are unleashing, you know, these commodities, if you want. And yeah, so we are, I think it's fair to say, still believers in the second camp, in the market camp, but we need a detailed analysis what the problems are right now. Mm-hmm. And renewables are absolutely ready to be players on a level playing field there.
Okay, thank you. I think you wanted to come back. Was it on that question indeed that he had posed about the capacity problem, or you wanted to come back on something else? Or generally?
Maybe a general impression. I think actually it's an extremely interesting discussion that we're having, but I think it's actually several discussions at once. There is one discussion on decarbonization. How do we get CO2 out of the system? And renewables being a tool for that. Mm-hmm. There's one discussion on market liberalization, the way we've liberalized markets and whether that scheme can work. And then there's a discussion on variable renewables and how you can technically integrate them and how you need to maybe tweak frameworks. And I think a number of things that are happening can actually be assigned to these different topics. And it's very important to distinguish between them, because otherwise we run into the problem of exactly what you mentioned, that there's lobbying going on that will confuse issues. I'll give you an example. Wind and solar are variable. Right now, the capacity factors of power plants are very low. They're being taken out of the market. The lights might go out, right? So it mixes the property of variable renewables with something where I would say has nothing to do with it, because it's actually an effect of decarbonizing the system. Why? Electricity is an extremely weird commodity in a sense, and decarbonizing the electricity system is very weird. Sometimes it's compared to introducing smartphones, and that people will then, like, PV is like introducing smartphones, and then people will radically adopt it. The problem is we're not trying to introduce new services when we decarbonize the system, but we're trying to change the way in how we provide these services. The electricity that's coming out of that plug will remain the same if it's high carbon or low carbon. The problem with that is it's not communicated to end consumers that they're actually getting a different product, and also we're lumping it together on the same market, which means that any kind of low-carbon generation that we put on the market and displace existing generation from this market will lead to this effect of overcapacity and oversupply. And exactly the political problem that's currently the case in Europe is one of displacing incumbents and the oversupply that we have compounded by economic crisis. But this is essentially a consequence of decarbonization compounded with the economic effect. It would be very similar. I mean, there's some details of how PV works, but it would be very similar if you were adding nuclear capacity. Who would be going out of the market? It would be gas, because it's most expensive to run, and currently the carbon price doesn't catch it. So the oversupply problem that we have, I would say, is one of decarbonization, primarily. Now, I would say the discussion around capacity markets has shown that when people actually went and looked into the capacity market, it was sold as something that caters for the variability of wind and solar, but actually, I think a lot of utilities, even if they didn't say it openly, hoped it would be a lifeline for capacity that wasn't used anymore. And now when you go and look and design capacity mechanisms that are not a subsidy mechanism, you find, actually, there's no demand for it. We have enough capacity. So there's exactly this confusion that's going on between a decarbonization issue and an overcapacity that we have, and then trying to mix it with the renewables, where there are issues for themselves. And I think it's quite crucial to take these apart. Now, how does... Mm-hmm. One more minute. Yeah. How does the market liberalization fit in there? The market design that we currently have in place, it's not just about the spot market. We have forward trading opportunities. I mean, a market essentially is just a way that two people can get together where one side wants to sell something and the other one buys something. It's actually quite fundamental. The question when we ask, is our market design actually working, is do we have the right number of people offering and the right number of people demanding, and on which time scale? Australia is often cited as an example where the spot market really works. They just have that one spot market, it's day-ahead spot market, and that's the proof that investments actually go ahead. Now, when you look at what the Australian regulator says, yeah, that's true, that's the regulated part of this market where we look, but we also look at the forward markets, where people just trade bilaterally, and we look that they have enough liquidity looking long ahead. Because when you buy a new power plant, it tends to be extremely expensive, and therefore, if you're sitting down with your banker, you need to have a long-term contract. So even in those systems where we have the ideal spot market design, you need some kind of way to refinance new capacity long-term. It could be a balance sheet of a utility, it could be a long-term PPA that you directly sign with someone who has need of electricity, but you need that long-term element. So for me, the question is not so much, you know, can we deal with something that is only a short-term market? That's an easy question. No, no way. But the question is, will people voluntarily, will they have the opportunity to, and will they voluntarily engage in long-term contracts, not for high-carbon electricity, but for low-carbon electricity? And I would say, in the current situation in Europe, no way. That's simply not going to work, because economic situation is bad, we have an oversupply, we don't need new capacity, and we're mixing both in two markets where both are providing the same service, essentially, and the only distinguishing feature between the two would be a carbon price, but we've tried that for 20 years, and I don't think it's credible to communicate that. And I would say that is actually at the bottom line of this, why we could discuss to need additional instruments. Because it's really a problem of decarbonization, a problem of transitional overcapacity. It's not so much a problem of variable renewables. There are problems associated with that. We do need flexibility, and there's a number of issues associated with that. But I think that's more the big framework.
Okay, let me stop here. Yes, I know you wanted to come in. Is this checked for the latecomers? Who's late? Who came in after us? Do you know who all these gentlemen are? Are we all good? Do you need to know? IEA, Commission? Yeah? Okay. We've got the utilities company here from Sweden, we've got the TSO, and we've got, on the end, EWEA. Okay, just in case, because nobody's got badges or big signs, so that's who we are. So, you wanted to come in, please, Tahir, from the Austrian Power Grid.
Yeah, I mean,
Grid.
Risking
to respond.
Taking away time from the audience, because they obviously need to say something or would like to say, I shall really make it clear. Mm-hmm. If we do not get these tools in hands, there will be disturbances, I don't want to call it blackouts. Because you must be aware that electric power system I learned 26 or 7 years ago when I was a young engineer was robust. It is the biggest and most complex machine in the world anyway, still. But the margin, security margin, system robustness, the way how system reacts on unforeseen events has narrowed. And it is narrowing ever and ever and more. So without judging what kind of generation here and there is. It's not just, you know, economical parameters are always interesting, but this shift from the conventional generation to the other kinds of generation would be similar economically if there was no technical difference. And I mentioned, and I repeat it once again, the new generation doesn't have heavy rotating masses. This is crucial. I know it's an engineering stuff, and I talked to Katrina before, you need not to know more than the electricity comes out of the wall. But to have it coming out of the wall, you need these bloody heavy rotating masses in the system, at last as long as we do have alternating current, AC. This is what Mr. Tesla invented 120 years ago. If you go for DC, it's different. But as long as we have AC, and everything you see on the NSOE map, it's AC, you know, it's lines with three phases and so on, this thing needs synchronous machines.
Okay.
And in the... No, I'm not...
Sorry. I just... There was a moment of a pause there.
It's engineering exposé now,
okay.
You know. One sentence only, yeah? So we are keeping system alive and we will continue to do so, but if we do not get these tools in our hands rather soon than later, everything will be at stake. So I just want to be understood very seriously about
disturbances, not blackouts.
No, about the tools, not disturbances.
I know, but we can't call them blackouts.
Disturbances
can
happen always, but the margin is disappearing.
Okay. Well, I'm sure we will have a further conversation on the tools, but before any of you guys jump in, please, there's some such clever, brainy people here. They will talk all the time and use up the entire rest of the hour if you don't speak. So please speak. There must be questions. There's so much been said. It's always the first... Yes, I was about to say the first person's the shy. It's the gentleman there in the nice tie. There's a lady with a... there's a lady with a microphone somewhere. Here? There's a... sorry, I didn't realise you are the hostess. Okay, there's a gentleman with a microphone. Thank you. Where
yes,
are you from?
Thank you, Patrick Van Hove from the European Commission DG Research and Innovation. One concept I didn't hear from the speakers is renewable portfolio obligation. So if one of the aim is decarbonisation, is that one possible solution or why not?
Who'd like to answer?
Do you mean the certificate system for subsidizing renewables, or what do you mean exactly by portfolio?
In some place in the market, the generation has to make sure that they procure a given part of the supply from renewable sources. And they of course, do that through market mechanism.
So it's a certificate system one way or the other. Yeah.
Well, the implementation is a detail.
Hang on, keep him the... Give him the microphone.
Yeah, the implementation, through certificates are another way, is a detail.
Are we clear? No, we're not clear in terms of you want to.
Well, I mean, you could frame the 2020 renewables target as an EU-wide obligation that has been put on the national level to national obligations that were then broken down with policy instruments and so forth. So I think if we frame this in terms of a renewables obligation, actually the 2020 renewables target was a binding obligation that was then implemented in a certain way. Now, you could think of other types of obligations where you mandate suppliers of electricity to procure a certain amount from renewable sources. But I think, again, when you have a market, that would create someone who's willing to buy, but it doesn't already fix the problem that you have someone who wants to sell. So in the early days of the market development, I think building up the renewables market was a critical component of that. Whether we could now transition to a phase where we put a binding obligation on suppliers to procure a certain amount from renewable sources, it's thinkable, but the political problems with that would be rather large.
I think he just wants to come here now, Tahir, and then we'll hear from Paul.
I think you answered Patrick correctly. What he was saying is basically, and I agree with it, in the beginning we had a certificate system with portfolio for the way of supporting renewables, then we would maximize the European renewables portfolio. What we are doing now, we are maximizing it locally. And if we had a certificate system, which works, when I worked for regulator, I had 1 year I was operating such a system for small hydro, then you would have a market which will decide which technology is good where. So we will have a lot of hydro in the Alps, a lot of sun down there in the south, a lot of wind in the North Sea, but not vice versa, where it's not really pays off as it should. So I think this should be really the right way to go. I don't know whether we can still do it now.
Paul, do you want to just come in?
Yeah, we had a lot of discussion also, at the renewable side, whether we can find a European solution. The answer was no, not even within the industry there was something like the best solution agreeable. I mean, luckily you have the fact that you have good wind speeds almost in every country somewhere, and they went now, and we have now, various support schemes that is a fact. However, I think with really large penetration levels, you can think about, for onshore at least, for something like a market premium model where you have a common methodology at least that takes into account wind resources, administrative costs, grid connection costs. So this is something that we can Europeanize, I think, if I understand your question correctly, in terms of, for onshore at least. Of course, you need to, it's something else for offshore, which is a much more juvenile technology, but you have to take into account not only the discrepancy for support schemes nationally, but also the discrepancy for administrative barriers, for the grid connection requirements, for all sorts of things. So a European solution was never really at hand unless you harmonize all these things as well.
Okay, and you want to finally come
just
back?
One short add-on to that. I mean, the moment you impose an obligation, different suppliers, different jurisdictions will be in a very different position to meet that obligation. So it would be unfair to some who are really in a difficult place to procure. That quickly leads to a certificate mechanism to trade, and that has a number of associated problems. I mean, the policy analysis where we've compared different types of support mechanisms, you actually see you get an increased risk for the price of these certificates. You have an increased uncertainty for investors that drives up the cost of capital. Therefore, because these are capital-intensive technologies, they tend to become more expensive, and the overall costs go up. That's one issue. The other issue is if you have only one certificate price, you give extremely high rents to people who are at the low-hanging fruit, just shove a little bit of biomass into a coal boiler, and you would get the same remuneration as someone who's trying to build the first offshore wind park. So it's also a question of dynamic efficiency of these schemes. And so I think that's one of the reasons why now the new market-based instrument is auctions.
Okay, can I just the two have a hand. Do you have a hand? Can I get these two guys in the middle talking, just so that we can, if you've got a question either for David or for Oliver, here. Yes, gentleman here.
Thanks very much. Yeah, my question's for Oliver, but also interesting to hear the rest of the panel's views. My name's Alison McGowan. I'm from a utility called SSC, operates in the UK and Ireland. My question would be in regards to an approach to, in terms of, we've had a number of very interesting comments and posed some very interesting questions that we have to deal with over the next decade or so. Unfortunately, I'm going to chuck in another issue in regards to actually attempting to complete the internal energy market. My question to Oliver would be, and I'll use two examples to reflect on these, is can we actually have a kind of harmonised approach to a European market if we don't have a harmonised approach to how we charge for use of the transmission system, notably generator charges known as G charges? For example, they're very, very high in Scotland. For the renewables industry, that's obviously an issue because obviously you want to be able to use the resource that, or the greatest resource that Europe has available to it. Mm-hmm. And actually, more recently, because of acute capacity issues in the GB market, we've seen gas power stations close, one of our own at Peterhead, which interestingly actually has one of the most developed CCS projects going forward. But also more recently, Iberdrola's coal power station opting out of the GB capacity mechanism. And obviously a number of people in this room would be surprised to hear coal actually opting out of capacity mechanism. Those two decisions and the renewables question have been based on the fact that there are additional costs to connect to the transmission system in Scotland. Is that something the Commission should look at, and are they looking at it?
I think that's for you then. Can we
answer directly? Welcome to the political world. It's certainly clear tariffs are an issue, and SUI is looking at NRAs are not happy about tariff harmonization. Unfortunately, member states, and that you have to keep in mind, I mean, yes, we want to build an internal market, but we don't have China. We are not China, we are the Balkans. Yeah, we have 28 single grids and even more TSOs operating this, not the regional one who would optimize and who would do this. And the 28 TSOs are all the more than 30 TSOs, belong to member states who want to have a say on what tariffs there are. And we have the scene of discussion with the wind. I'm sitting with the wind. It can be make quite a difference what you charge for whatever, a new wind farm somewhere. It is on our plate, but let's say in the priorities list, what is politically feasible, technically necessary, we have a couple of, as Tai said, the network costs, the harmonization projects, and what is very high is certainly to get, if we cannot have joint grid operation, at least a harmonized grid operation in this Balkans of TSOs. And you can ask the question now to Tahir, why did he not propose at least to single regional corporations? Why do we have TSA and Coreso, not a single one? That is, for me, a question I have no clue. I have also no clue why in the details of harmonization, we go for a lot of processes of future agreements on something, but even on this level of detail, it seems to be extremely difficult for member states and for national systems, who all love and like their national systems, to give up something towards a harmonized rule. So if we tackle tariffs, and I'm the first one who would love to tackle first, you will pretty much see this will be not the easiest part in the whole equation. And we don't think, in terms of effects for the internal market, it is the most urgent thing to do, but it doesn't say we want to park it. We see a pressing need to get an internal intraday market, we have a balancing market, short-term markets in place to have the possibility of aggregation. And then within an aggregated zone, then to provide for fair pricing is also important, but we, in our current priority list, quite frankly, it's not on number one. Fortunately or unfortunately, it doesn't mean it's off the hook.
Yes, Tahir, you want to add?
I somehow feel I have to express a little bit of wondering that, Oliver, you say this. I mean, you call us Balkans of TSOs. It remains up to you or the audience to assess what does this mean. But You should know that in the operation security code, there is the obligation for TSO to participate in something we call regional security cooperation initiative. This is really a complex, complicated technical abbreviation, but this is the thing. One is in Brussels, it's called Corezo. One is in Munich, it's called TSE. And they do part of the work, which is load flow calculation, or just to say simply, all calculations needed in the whole of Europe are not done anymore by a single TSO. And it is so for years already. And we have now, and what I was talking about, the tools, I did not want to mention those. If you want to see this, visit me. Come to my control center, you will see the same thing. If you go to Germany, to Netherlands, to Switzerland, even the non-European Union Switzerland is working together. So we have something which is called common grid model. Again, engineering stuff, but this is the data, names of lines, resistances, and so on, put together to calculate my 24-hour simulations and so on. And we can only do this together for the whole of Europe. So we do have regional coordination centers already, because otherwise we would not be able to survive. And forgive me, Oliver, this was before your time. It all happened after the 4th of November 2006. This was a time when there was a ship in Germany going to the sea, and the system was split. And we saw there already, Cecilia was working for TSOs that time and so on, that there is no way to operate the system as an island. So yes, we do have regional centers. And the reason why we have two, they're not enough. We will have to have four. Because it's such a serious business, you must have it redundant, secure. Cybersecurity is most concerning issues in my life recently. Honestly, it's really a serious issue. So you will have not just to cover geographic areas in a way that makes sense, because Corezo covers kind of Great Britain, France, Italy, and so on. There is a central one, TSC covers kind of Germany, Poland, Denmark, part of Spain. But then the Spain, the Balkans, so we'll have probably three or four of those, and they will have to have server machines, computer, machinery, everything, the same, running on two, because by law, I am obliged to have a backup control center in small Austria. Well, in big Europe, you would probably not want to have one coordination center for the whole of TSOs. So the reason why we have two is that we did not yet cover all we need. We will have four. And these four will be backup for each other. And once again, indeed, we do calculate the European grid from Lisbon to Warsaw, even further on with Baltic states, from Great Britain is part of it, to Greece, all together in one, really one, we call it common grid model.
Okay. David, you want to add something?
Yeah, well, listening to all these very interesting conversations, it just struck me that in the Nordics, we built 60 terawatts of hours of nuclear between 79 and 85 or something. And of course, the system was then designed to transmit on that capacity, on those markets. But it was an impressive capacity that was built in so little time. Mm-hmm. If just looking ahead, we're talking about integration. Of course, it's a different kind of animal with the intermittent power. But my firm belief is that we have a much lower pace now. Of course, there will be a lot of technical issues in the system when phasing out nuclear in the Nordic system and phasing in intermittent power. There will be voltage frequency issues, there will be voltage issues, there will be rotor angle issues, yes, but that's technology, which is associated with the cost, of course, that will end up in the hands of the TSO, of course. Mm-hmm. But it is not the question of, I don't think it's the question of changing a market, it's the question of a triangle between the TSO needs to decide on the size of the reserve power. It's the corner of utilizing the potential we have with the demand elasticity, and I think it's also the angle of we just need to optimize over a bigger area, so in sort of transmission capacity. I think it's just not changing model doesn't really help anything. We have a good model, a robust model that is cost efficient, is my belief, and just taking that step by step will handle the issue. Is my firm belief.
Mm-hmm. You want to add to this, or you want to come back to the gentleman who asked the question?
Just two comments, actually. Mm-hmm. Both what? the The first thing is all this nuclear capacity, of course, was built under the vertically integrated model, right? I mean, not before market liberalization. And I think the reason why we started off this process in market liberalization with a comfortable system, as you described, is the primary driver for liberalizing markets was overcapacity, right? The view that actually utilities were overinvesting, that this was too expensive for consumers, and we've eaten away this overcapacity. And in fact, competitive generation markets, if you would read the disclaimer package on it, may lead to tight capacity situations. That's clearly stated on there, and actually that's a feature, not a bug, because it saves money that you would otherwise dump into power plants that you then might not need. On the vertically integrated model, where you have a monopoly provider, you would read, will probably lead to overinvestment, but you won't have problems with security of supply. So I think these are just two models, and if we were to go back to the vertically integrated days, I think all the capacity adequacy problems would go away. But probably the bills would keep rising more and more, and competition and new entrants of the market would be blocked. I mean, that's what you really see in systems like Japan, for example. The vertically integrated model is hostile to innovation, and I think that's the that's a big problem in that. I'm not saying that it's all in Japan, but some examples I think would show that. Now, when it comes to the grid the grid coordination, I think these were two aspects actually. One is, if we think of the TSOs as the doctor of the electricity system, and when the electricity system is really sick, they need to treat it quickly. Having a common grid model means that you're treating the same patient. I mean, in the absence of a common grid model, in the absence of having a common view on what's happening in the system, you don't even know, you wouldn't even be able to agree who the patient is. But when you turn around and you look at what medicine you have to treat the patient, it's still very different from the different TSOs. In fact, if you think of the balancing markets and the reserve markets as the medicine that you need to keep, different TSOs are applying different remedies. And system operation essentially still is, just like medicine, evidence-based and a science, but it's also a bit of an art. And if I was a TSO and responsible for system security, I would stick to the protocols that have worked in the past, not to jeopardize security of supply. And now we're asking from the TSOs, just throw that out of the window and come up with a new one that you all use. I mean, that's like asking a set of doctors, please treat all the patients in the same way that you're, or agree on a way to treat a patient, people that have been practicing for a long time. I think that's a problem. Now, the issue with the wind in Scotland is a radically different one.
Can you keep it short? Because yes. He wants to come back on that one.
Okay.
So just thank you.
It costs money to transport electricity. It costs a whole bunch of money to store electricity. That's really different from a lot of other things that we have an internal energy market for. And until and unless we acknowledge that fact, we're not going to have a good one. And because the wind in Scotland blows very strong, that's true, but it's also very far away from a lot of the load centres, it just might not be the optimal way to put everything in Scotland. In particular, because the cost reductions of wind energy have been very high in past years in lower wind speed sites. So it's much less and less true that put the wind where the wind blows strongest. Yes, there needs to be wind, but actually the cost reductions in low wind speed sites have been quicker than the cost reductions in high wind speed sites. So that optimum is shifting all the time, and I'm sorry to say it's probably shifting away from Scotland a bit.
Okay. And I'm sure you can engage him further afterwards, and he will give you more information. Yes.
I feel we do not inform you correctly. We are bothering with technicalities, and you are bored. Come to the control center of Elia to see how I operate my system. Go to Corezo to see how TSC works. Go to Tenet to see what I do to counteract this malade, as you said, with medicine. 10 years ago, we have abandoned the old tools. I have no chance to operate my system, to fulfill my responsibility for security without all these guys in TSC and Corezo. So obviously, you are not informed well. I can only say this. If you want to see how system is run today, go to any control center, not to mine. If you are far away from Austria, go to your control. I'm not talking about England. Or go to Scandinavia, go to Denmark. Yeah? You will see the same screen in Denmark, the same screen, the same load flow calculation, the same control actions. We call it multilateral remedial action. This is a redispatching involving up to 5 or 6 TSOs. We do this daily to survive. If I did not do it, you will have no power anymore.
Okay, thank you.
I can only say this, sorry.
Thank you. The gentleman here.
Thank you. My name is Ivan Pineda from the European Wind Energy Association. It's very reassuring hearing what you say about the operation. The system is the same way everywhere. So that's why we have the lights on. And probably we shouldn't talk about then why it's so difficult to get the network
put together. I don't want to
together.
Reassure you. Don't be too certain. I didn't want to make you very comfortable.
No, that's what I'm saying. So probably if everybody's operating the system in the same way, we shouldn't have so much trouble to put in the network calls all together. And we shouldn't be in the position that we are, and et cetera. But my question was more fundamental to the very set of tools that you were mentioning at the very beginning. And it's going to be a very blunt question and probably very naive. But when you mentioned that we need rotating masses for delivering whatever amount of electricity and that we are losing them because of the renewables, with a mere 11% of renewable generation at the moment, how much do you need in terms of rotating masses? In Ireland, as far as I understand, you have up to 50% of non-synchronous penetration, and they work the system quite well. How much do we need in Europe of these rotating masses, and for how long?
Ireland is an island, and the answer is nobody knows. We are just currently running some very intensive scientific studies with some universities, because in Operation Security Code there is an article on this inertia issue, because this has never been done before. It's really something where you even cannot buy a product off the shelf, off the counter. It's really a serious matter, because we are talking about it now, hopefully not having to deal with it in a few years from now. Now it's not yet that far. We have still a lot of machines around. Yeah, but this is the if we look to the forecast, if we look to the announcement of how much wind and solar power is coming, and if we look to the Commission's guidelines 2030, it's clear that more than 50% will come from renewables. Whatever, not just from water, from non-synchronous machines. And then to deal with it, we have to think about it now. But the answer to your question is, I have no clue.
There you go, he hasn't got a clue.
And we will learn
it
in the next time. Yeah.
Thank you. Paul, you have remained silent and pensive and mysterious at the end of the row, so I'm just going to throw this in another direction. We're talking about markets. Renewables are expected to adapt to markets. In your view, how should the markets adapt to renewables? I mean, not only for renewables, but for all power generation. Are there any more best practices? You talked about Spain. You talked about best practice examples. Have you got any more examples? And what's your overall view on that in terms of adapting in both directions?
Yeah. Well, I mentioned briefly... grid support services markets, which are, we see them developing in some places right now. Ireland is an example. They have ancillary services is synonymous for this. So we see some places where this is more and more procured on a national level. However, this is really rather an exception than the rule. So I think this is one part how markets should develop. Intraday imbalancing, I think there we see really a very patchy development. You have some fairly well-developed intraday markets. Nord Pool is a good example of a regionally integrated market model, I must say. But in some other places throughout Europe, there's really not much going on. And yeah, there's a vast discrepancy within Europe. When you look at new member states in particular, you know, there's places where commercial power exchange exists because of historical reasons only since a couple of years. And when we go there, when we visit the wind farm sites there's a lot of intransparencies and they're really at the beginning of liberalization, if you want. So there's curtailment practices where we really tweaked ourselves and priority dispatch given to all sorts of power plants, and therefore there is a vast discrepancy. And in some places, you know, I would really be quite careful with even removing priority dispatch from some really ill-liberated markets. Whereas you have very mature, liberalized, well-functioning and liquid marketplaces in Europe with high penetration of renewables where we don't need these features anymore, which were kind of a protective device, if you want, against lack of liberalization or large incumbents, if you want. So there is a vast change in this. I mean, the no-regret option is, with or without renewables, of course, the rollout of intraday markets. Yeah, and this is really what we are badly waiting for. The Commission is on the case, we know. It's now really the intraday software solution. I think we hope there's progress soon on this.
Intraday market is running. I have 40% of trades are intraday. It's about 40 gigawatt hours per day in Austria. Germany has 10 times more.
Well, I mean, but
depends what you understand it. If it's continuous trading in real time, not, but up to 1 hour, Elbas is doing it 10 minutes before real time.
Yeah. No, the continuous trading solution would be nice.
Well, it will work somewhere, but not in the continental Europe. Yeah. As I explained, this is the problem of the mesh grid. So.
Just one
I couldn't possibly stop you, otherwise you're going to throw yourself onto the floor from the stage, I think, or
just,
pound
just to give one example, I mean, I was sitting with EPEX Spot, and we were discussing about intraday markets. And so it was, okay, so you have a 15-minute product that I can trade in Germany, but I can't trade it in France. It was in 2013. I don't know whether the problem's been fixed. Yeah, and I said, that's really weird. And then I asked, why is that? The metering of German power plants is 15 minutes and that French power plants is 10 minutes aggregated to half an hour. It doesn't really square. We can't resolve 15 minutes with a 10-minute meter power plant. It's legacy protocol. It's differences in the way the system is run that are very old. I mean, this is not something where it's impossible to do it. It's just embedded in the structure that makes collaboration difficult. And this is taking away liquidity from intraday markets that would be dearly needed between Germany and France. So really, this is just one example, and you could name several examples also in terms of balancing markets that TSO use where legacy protocol are a barrier.
Oliver.
I can just say music in my ears. I rarely get this support because it's precisely when we are faced with liberalization and with what indeed the network codes are, what we face every day, that every single rule is not, yes, let's harmonize, let's go for whatever, 12.5, then everybody has to change, or 15 or 10. The utmost we get in this proposed legislation is let's start a process and discuss how in future we may have a common rule. This is the state of play, and with all optimism and all respect for what has been done, and it's a lot, we have a fundamental problem of harmonization. And I like the doctor's example. We need to agree that we want to harmonize. This agreement currently, I have just to state, after dealing now a couple of years with harmonization, the fundamental agreement between member states is not there. There's a lot of goodwill, a lot of projects there, but a fundamental agreement that there's also a need to give up something is not there. I would be a bit more lenient that the harsh statement that we just across the board create from scratch, now we ask Simon, he designs us the perfect balancing market and this is just implemented everywhere, will also not fly. But we need to learn exactly where the boundaries of harmonization are and where we need, and I could agree and give you 10 examples where it's obvious that we need a harmonization. It's just, and it starts with a silly intraday computer, which is still not running. And it's so silly for 2 years for a simple project. And there are many political and other interests behind why this is not working. There, we have an issue, and with all goodwill, I must, in this point, indeed support Simon's problem. We have an issue, and we have to openly say we're not sure that everybody wants internal market from the Commission side.
So from your side, is the glass even half full? I mean, you spoke before about it. Okay, it takes time. Okay, there are different cultural criteria. There are different backgrounds. There are different people optimizing their own national markets.
It can be very concrete. I use the tipping point. We're really between half full and half empty, and it's the next months, years that will decide. Very concretely, on November, I have to decide about a market coupling regulation. You would have had the chance. There are two provisions about price caps. Nobody in this room, nor on this educated panel, they all say, oh, we need demand response and we need to incentivize flexibility. I've not heard anybody proposing a price cap rule in this code that says, for instance, we should have a price cap that's not below 10,000 euros or something. I mean, politically, would have been daring. I don't know if I can get it through. But I did even not get the proposal. That would have been something concrete. So I would love these educated discussions to be very concrete, to look into what our policy proposals are. The next one is the balancing code. Shall we buy it and say, okay, in 10 years we will have something? Or do you ask us to do something more? And you seem to ask us to do something more, but then get involved in the political discussion. Don't stay off in your nice fora and universities, but get involved. Take a position and argue this. That may help more than abstract discussions, because we are between half full and half empty right now, and the statements I get every day in terms of future fate of market are not always promising.
Is that fair? Do you need to roll up your sleeves and make your hands dirtier?
Well, the IEA distinguishes between policies and politics, and we like to give policy advice and stay out of the politics. I know it's a quite insatisfactory answer. No, but
it's a political answer.
Yeah, it's a well. Essentially, that's what I was pointing to in the very beginning, that it's a redistribution issue. And there's a redistribution going on between, you know, renewable generators, conventional generators, liberalized consumers and or wholesale consumers, retail consumers, and also between the interests of TSOs and many other stakeholders. And I think the problem is that we're dealing with such a technical issue, and that then these technical issues kind of mask the political trade-offs that are there. There's also a huge security of supply question. Are national states really willing to give up the individual capacity adequacy of their system? I mean, analysis is pretty clear. It'll be much cheaper to do that, but then the political reality might be quite different.
Thank you, Paul.
Yeah, the other aspect is that the regulatory vehicles where we, you know, enshrine all these things are network codes, which are, you know, a very specific piece of regulation with a very specific way of developing it by NSOE in a fairly formalized manner. We invest a lot of time in it, but now many network codes, you know, are in a fairly mature state of draft, and it's not, well, it's not very easy to engage for external stakeholders. Many don't even know about it, that they exist. Now, I think now the word is more and more out, but when we were talking 3-4 years ago about network codes, everybody would scratch their head. And now actually the importance of these network codes, you know, this is binding European regulation directly applicable everywhere. This is now, I think, more acknowledged. And for me, this is still, I think it's fair to say for the electricity industry, this altogether, this is still, you know, the main tool. And there I'm still afraid where we are with them. I know there are some issues, bits and bobs to be fixed. A lot of that stuff is actually pushed to national level, to national implementation, because we could not find an explicit European solution. So there is certain, well, misinformation, I would say, and lack of engagement by all stakeholders in establishing really solid rules.
Okay, you wanted to say?
Yeah. Shall say, codes, it's no tool at all. It's as good as any other law, as good as you implement it. So when we get these codes, we only at the beginning of the really doing something and making it happen. And this is the reason why I said on inertia, yes, we will know it better. Oliver would like it to be changed very fast. But imagine the European electricity 5 years ago. It was a different animal. Can you imagine it in 5 years from now? I only hear that there will be 70 gigawatts more wind power in Germany or somewhere else. What does this mean? You know? So we are making these calls. They are very nice, but they are not really a solution. They're just a framework which then has to be implemented in order to make this Energiewende happen. Just to make it really clear what the codes are and how they will help us solve it.
Can I just directly, if you allow me, correct Tahir there? Because
always.
I mean, the codes are indeed what was said, and that is a fundamental misunderstanding I have been facing for 2 years. There was the understanding on the side of Acer and SUI that the codes are indeed kind of preparatory technical legislation for a future harmonization process. This is the core of why you ask us why we don't adopt the codes. The Commission has a totally different view. We see the codes to addressing Simon's problem. We have different rules. That doesn't make sense. We want to sit together and come to a harmonized, efficient solution. That is the idea, has been the idea of the code. Unfortunately, those who have written it had a different mindset. And the very reason why it takes longer now is that we want to fix at least a bit of it and to bring a bit of harmonization into the regulations. And don't mix it up. There are no network codes. Network codes is just a proposal somebody gave us on the table with a lot more transparency than a normal regulation. Normally, I would have sat down with some experts, proposed regulation, adopted it, and it's done. And you would have had the chance to be involved or not. The network codes process gave you much more transparency than in any other form of regulation. Even if you're not happy with it, I would say you have more involvement, at least in the last years. Maybe the kickstart with the TSO's development was not perfect always, but I think we had to broad involvement and broader than in other parts of legislation. But the fundamental misunderstanding about the harmonization project of the network codes is that they're not meant as some technical silly rules for a future harmonization process. They're meant to harmonize. Now, they can be adapted every 2 years. Even if things change, we will change them. Network codes in railway legislation are changed every 3 months. We are ready to change them and to adapt them. But what we are unhappy with is that they are indeed proposing a process in balancing. It's drastic. It's a 10-year process. And we are not convinced that this is the right approach. And we are just negotiating with stakeholders. And we'll just decide for another proposal.
Hang on a second. Can I just ask? There's no other TSOs in the house, just by any chance, is there, who could add to this? There seems to be a misunderstanding. We're claiming no. But go on. You put your hand up. I'm just going to stop you a second there. Can I hear from this gentleman? Yes.
No, I wanted to shift a bit the discussion.
Okay.
From
can you
the
hold
tools
your thought,
and
then?
The codes to a different subject, which I don't know if it was intentional, but has not been touched upon from any of the speakers.
It was probably intentional.
Probably, yes. Yeah. Because I want to ask your opinion. What is your take on the devastating, I could say, impact to the final consumer tariff that renewables had, or this dash for renewables with feed-in tariffs? And in some markets who may not be touched by Vattenfall or SSE, there have been some very, very sad stories of really human destruction. People who have given everything to those fantastic feed-in tariffs of 450 euros per megawatt hour and 20 years contracts. And of course, then the state had to crudely intervene and slash them in half and tax them, and you know, nothing has been mentioned about this. But apart from that, because this is maybe in some failed states, nevertheless European and more obscure markets, what is your take on a recent study by the US Department of Energy, which has calculated the cost of renewable integration around $10 per kilowatt hour final, if you like, price for the consumer. So to these levels, do you have any position whether in Europe we can do it less or it will cost more?
Oliver, he was looking at you in a very serious fashion there. Do you wish to come back on that?
Very short. I mean, first question, we were asked not to replicate the subsidies discussion. Yeah. I would have loved to talk about malfunctioning and not well-designed support schemes for nuclear and all kinds of stuff. I did not do so.
Okay.
The second point, again, I'm not in a blame game for renewables. I mean, we've done a kind of cost study. We've published it on Monday. That is the first attempt. But I mean, clearly, I mean, and I don't want to have the debate, what are the costs of nuclear integration, the real costs. What I can say is, even there, I don't care about the $10 in the US. Renewables integration in the Nordic countries is a nice thing. If I have water all around, I can balance it easily, integrate in the system. That's an easy thing. I mean, it's still complex and difficult, but it's a very difficult, different thing than doing this in whatever, northern Germany, southern Germany, all kinds of other regions. So these simplistic answers for me, I'm not able to say it's 10 or 12, and if so, it's an aggregated figure, and for this you have the experts. All I can say is what is much more important, and it has an impact on the cost, is how do we get the intraday market, so we need some harmonization effort, how do we get demand side kicking off, so we need price incentives. How do we get this process started? And with the workable, and we've not talked about demand side there, I'm rather a bit skeptical. I'm surprised. I thought you wind guys, you would ask us to talk about how do we get the demand side kicking off.
We've still got a bit of time, you know. It'll all come at the last minute, don't you worry.
If we have a working demand side and a smart world, industry really starting off, and consumer demand side starting off, the costs are minimal. If we don't have it, the costs are high. I mean, this is for me much more important than having. Sorry.
Hang on a minute. Can you guys? Because you all want to speak, so can you keep it short? So come back to this gentleman, and then I can take this gentleman. Yes, you wanted. Can we keep it really concise?
I fully support that point. The question of integration costs, assigning it to variable renewables, is asking the wrong question. Integration costs quantify an interaction between the remaining system on one side and the variable system on the other side, and the question is how well they fit together. Now, if you assume that side of the system, the residual system, to be extremely inflexible, you can calculate any number you want. If you then go through the options that are available to make the system more flexible, a more flexible demand side, shifting towards more flexible generation that is not as expensive to build, coupling it with the heat sector and so forth, these numbers start to go lower and lower and lower. At some point, if you take it to very, very high penetration levels, you do get to quite high numbers, actually in the order of magnitude that you've cited. But really, the question is, how do we make the system as a whole flexible? But that's a long-term question. I mean, the problem of this is, I think, There's been good progress on the day-ahead timescale, but now we have to go in two directions, essentially, on the short timescale of intraday and balancing markets, but on the longer timescale to transform the system, get flexibility and secure investment.
Okay, Paul.
For I think you can find many good answers on your question in the it was on Monday in the published report, interim report by the Commission on support schemes to the entire power sector, and we are of course thrilled to see then the historical analysis to give the full picture in terms of support schemes that have been also historically been paid to conventionals, as well as more information about externalities on fossil fuel power generation. So I think this should answer the question in a more thorough way, mm-hmm. rather than me saying much more now.
Okay, yes. Tahir, he wants to come in.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. I'm terribly sorry that we have again neglected who is the most important one. And this is us, taxpayers and bill payers. It's 500 million individuals. And I'm proud that my fellow TSO guy mentioned this. If I worked for a regulator, I would have raised the same question. And we have again managed to just neglect it. And we are talking about intraday and things. What about the one who is paying the bill? Mm-hmm. This is my one statement. And just to say, Oliver, we as TSOs, me personally and all of us, we understand these codes with only one purpose. For all these customers we sell, because we are service providers, to have market and security work in the future. Yes, every legislation might be better in 5 years or in 3 years. We can make it perfectly binding with all the details and so on. But forget it, this is real world. You can never make it perfect. So either you put it now in place, we change it, you do something. If it's not good, we have to rewrite it, but it will never be perfect. And it will never be so perfect that there is nothing needed anymore.
Okay. Yeah, the gentleman at the back, please.
Okay, so coming to the demand side. So I also missed a little bit of discussion. So I totally agree what the colleague from Scandinavia said, that there are in particular big industries interested to contribute. This already was in the past, decades ago. But my fear is that in the near and in the future, we still will not be able to manage to integrate the demand side in the mass market. So why? One of the big problems is we do not have a price elasticity of electricity. So we simply do not have it. Electricity or the prices, let's say, they are too low. It's a low interest product. It's not the price signals are not that we have a scarce good. And the problem with electricity is compared to a mobile phone and so on, we cannot hear it, we cannot smell it. It's not sexy. This is one of the biggest problems, and therefore it's also a very small fraction compared to our monthly or annual income. And this is the big problem, and therefore I fear that we also cannot manage, except of course a few niche markets, so the big industries, and of course a few aggregators, they aggregate a few refrigerators and bid into the secondary and tertiary market. We have field studies and that. So this is the problem with the policy statement of the European Commission. So maybe Mr. Koch can give a statement on that. On the one hand, we want to have low prices. Mm-hmm. We have them now. And on the other hand, we want to have a demand-side management or demand response. This is not possible.
Okay, Mr. Koch, first of all, let me just turn to David, because I think he wanted to come respond to that.
Right. Yeah, I just wanted to build on my colleague's question here, that, of course, we don't really know exactly how the business models will look like eventually, but we know that there will be a demand. I'm certain of that there will be a market for it, and the need for that market will be increasing. We have not had that demand very, very significantly. But there's a variety of business models that one can look at. I think the utility side can play a very important role as being an aggregator to the mass market, between the mass market and the TSO, for example. But I think what is important is, of course, that the price, the real price, uncapped real price signals will follow through. That will create that elasticity of demand. So I think that is very important, that needs to have that dynamics, because otherwise it won't happen. So a real price signal that actually follows through, I think, is very important. I think that will be, of course, it will test, that again will test the efficiency of the system, or the trust of the system, or the public or the acceptance of the system. But I think that will also show the real problems towards the end user. I think it needs to be an uncapped price signal that will create that demand, and then there will be business models to it. Yes, but that's because the price signals are not there. No. They're not big enough.
You can save maybe a few euros or 10 or 20 euros. So you simply do not...
today, yes.
Yeah, today.
Yeah. I mean, if I can...
Yeah, just come in and then I know someone wants to speak.
Again,
yeah.
Scarcity pricing. I asked the question, should we do it? And I want
yes.
the answer.
Yes.
It's a political problem. I'm ready to go... to fight for it and to say it's efficient, because of course there's big industry waiting, and I'm traveling and I took my bike, get out to the association, ask them, why don't you offer all your energy? What is happening there? And for them it makes a difference if there's a cap or if there's chances for hours or longer periods to earn a bit of money. So it's, that will mean, however, and we at the fringe to the policy side have then to explain, that means you have to live with a bit of flexibility in your system. And French customers don't like it. If the price goes to 400, they're already panicking and there's a big political discussion. That will be very difficult to sell. I'm ready to fight for it because my economists tell me it's efficient, it will do a lot, and we need it. I'm convinced we won't get, with all nice leaflets, demand response and smart grids, if you don't have the incentive. So you need flexibility and flexible prices. That is clear, but then recommend us to do so, and tell us, get rid of your price caps in the CECM code. Nobody tells me. It's a lot of nice discussions. I think it's very easy, the recipes, and I'm personally ready to fight for it if I have sufficient public support for it.
Simon, do you want to add?
Well, first of all, it's a totally different animal, industrial demand response and consumer demand response. In industrial demand response in Scandinavia, it's actually already happening. People who have long-term contracts choose to sell short-term into the spot market, and the only way we discover it is a load forecast error, because all of a sudden the load isn't there that was normally expected. So actually, large companies on Nord Pool are already doing this, and we can expect that with higher prices. I mean, this is at 1,500 euros per megawatt hour, I think, is the cap there. So if you have like 3,000, something like that, you'll mobilize a lot of the potential. Now, when it comes to individual consumers, I disagree. I don't think that the preference structure of, you know, I don't want to have the risk of my utility bill. I open it. Oh, there was a price spike because there was a cold snap. I will now pay 500 euros for this month's utility bill. I don't want that. Right? I mean, price exposure on the wholesale market for the people who can manage it, for the people who contract with retail consumers. But where you have very high prices, they're not directly fed to the end consumer. Now, the problem is electricity has extremely high consumer rents. When you start asking around how much are you willing to pay to charge your smartphone, you arrive at price spikes that are 10 times, 100 times higher than the highest prices we have on any electricity market. So the problem is, even if we feed through these price signals, for a lot of the things that we do, you know, my willingness to pay to not wash my clothes by hand is very high. And the electricity price I need for my washing machine is a universe away of what it would need to be. But companies that are successful in the US don't sell it via the utility bill. They say you're going to get a $50 Walmart gift card if you do this. We just install a little device. You separate it. People like gift cards, so they do it, because you have a high-value service and you decouple it. People are also interested in saying, I'm going to guarantee you that your price remains stable for 5 years, for 10 years maybe. I contract demand-side flexibility with a source that gives me predictably priced power, such as wind energy, and then the thing starts to work. So I think the service that we're looking at to get customer-side demand-side response is really something of price stability. In the longer term, that can make it interesting, and getting high-value services with different business models. To allow that, I think we need infrastructure rollout. That's
but
a real barrier.
Can I just clarify, this does not mean you're against scarcity pricing, because that's what we explain politicians. They say, oh my God, my grandmother, she will pay 1,000 euros. Even with scarcity price, with intelligent services, of course, you can guarantee the same price over time, and even maybe cheaper than in a capacity markets world.
Yes, but I would say the scarcity prices for the wholesale market, and not, I would actually regulate against people having a pass-through of the full wholesale market price. If you really allow them to rise, you know, expose people to risk, but give them the instruments to hedge according to their risk preferences.
And my assumption of private customers is they have an adversity to price risk when it comes to electricity. So that's the reason why, yes, high price spikes on wholesale power markets, but then don't feed everything to the retail customer, because when they really get high, it's going to be outraging. And normally, the value of the service is going to beat the price that you're paying by so much that you just can't be asked. So these would be services that run in different business models.
Got two here. Are there any outraged consumers here? I just always wonder in all this discussion, you know, where is the consumer element? I mean, really, how much power is...
There was one there.
You know. Yes, you wanted to.
Yeah, two things which are completely out of my responsibility now, but I remember my past. In Norway, there is a demand response market with households for very only reason that a Norwegian household spends about 12,000 kilowatt hours per year. So as colleague behind puts it, it's a mess. It's a volume. So that's the reason why it functions. And the second thing is, we might like it or not, but the market, any commodity market, is very much dependent on elasticity. And there was a year where Norwegian, I just know it because there was quite interesting regulator study which I used to run then. There was a year where Norway had sold all its water to Sweden and there was no rain coming after. And Norwegian market only survived because there was very short reaction time upon contracts. So if you want to have market, then you have to take it with all the goods and the bads. You cannot take a little bit of the market and then have protect the customers or vice versa. It's just to complete this discussion, how can it work or not. So if you want to have long-term contract and not be affected, but participate in the market, then it's not a market, it's something else.
David, he wanted to add something.
Just a short comment to Simon's comment. Of course, I totally agree that we cannot have outraged customers. We cannot have, it will not be politically acceptable to have that kind of price signals. But I think there needs to be price signals enough so business models will develop. Which is not at hand at the moment. So I think needs to be some kind of price, at least more price signals for the companies to actually be able to be interested in those American models or whatever models there are to support the system or the TSO and hedge the risk, of course, with the price signal that the end user will otherwise have.
Okay. Now, I've just been reliably informed. I was merrily going on till 6 o'clock. For some reason, I thought we had till 6 o'clock. So actually, we didn't. We had till 5:30. So I'm going to have to wind things up now. The debate was so complex and there was so much to say. But let me just say, and I really mean this, guys, I mean a two-sentence roundup. What is the last message that you wish to leave with our audience from your point of view of today? And I really mean two sentences, bish, bash, bosh, and we're out so that these lovely people can have a drink and I can thank people. First up, Simon, please. Literally, two sentences.
The current economic problem about renewables integration is a lot about decarbonization, and that's the actual issue. And cost-effective integration of variable renewables will need grids and demand-side response.
Thank you. Oliver.
Thanks a lot. Very interesting discussion. Give us implementable policy advice, for instance, on scarcity pricing, how to implement it. Give us recipes, how to come to efficient harmonization, and we will be ready to implement this. Don't spend too much time in abstract ivory towers. Look at concrete implementation, and that can make a difference.
Thank you. David?
Thank you. We have good experience with energy-only market. We think that we can handle the integration of renewables by taking that model step by step. We think it is an efficient, cost-efficient way of doing it, and we think that price should be the messenger to the market.
Thank you. Tahir.
We can do this. We can do this integration of wind and solar power if we have proper tools. But please, let us not forget us. Let us not forget the bill payer, the customer.
Okay, and finally?
All right. If you want to save money, if you want to save the customer, do two things. Yeah. Well, maybe if you want to relieve the customer, then improve system operation. Do it like TSOs did it in Ireland, like TSOs did it in Spain, Portugal, Denmark. There's a lot to learn. If you want to save even more money, complete the internal energy market and roll out intraday and balancing markets. Think about what system services market could do for you, but then also forget not to find one size fits all solutions. There will be case specific things that will have to happen according to market maturities, RES penetration levels, local specificities, etc. So this is the balance to be struck.
Okay, thank you. So, before you all rush for the door and the trays of booze, can I just say a few thank yous? First of all, of course, to our speakers, thank you very much for coming here for such a wide-ranging debate. Look, I sat these people here for 15 minutes longer than I should, and they were all interested, so well done to you. Thank you also... you clap. Go on, you may clap. Thank you very much for your questions as well. Took the pressure off me, so thank you very much. I hope that you found the debate wide-ranging. Well, it was certainly wide-ranging, but that it was thought-provoking. I hope also that you got your questions answered. If you didn't, grab these guys afterwards and force them to answer your questions. I just do need to let you know that if you really want to see the whole thing again or simply how pretty everybody looked on camera, it has been videoed. I think there will be a link sent. And, of course, you are very welcome to participate again on the 18th of November in this very room in the last in the series of these debates entitled Turning the EU's 2030 Targets into a Stable Framework. No need, really, I think, to explain the content there. Till then, I bid you adieu. Stretch your legs, go and have a drink, chat some more, ask these guys questions. Thank you very, very much for coming. Thank you.
Thank you.